I made a list! Man, lists are so hard to make for manga, you just have no idea. So this one's about video games. The fact that the term JRPG even exists is pretty strange. But the RPG genre of games was created about the same time in America and Japan with wildly different styles of play. So what is it that makes it a JRPG? I don't know.
Hell, you can't even make the distinction geographically, as some Japanese companies have made Western-style RPGs and vice versa. It's a very holistic distinction that can be split up on gameplay and story design levels. Though, I don't think there will be any debate about the choices I made for this list. The golden age of the JRPG was in the 90s, with them dominating the SNES's lineup, and Final Fantasy VII being an enormous breakout hit on the PlayStation. But they have fallen out of favor of late.
Like many things that were popular in the 90s.
And I'm just gonna say, I'm not a fan of the genre. It's not from lack of trying, either. I just find that the stories are rarely good enough to get me to muscle through the dull, tedious gameplay, and even when the story is stronger, I often give up halfway through when the plot goes into a holding pattern while you collect seven of something.
For it is always seven of something. So consider this a list of JRPGs for people who don't really like JRPGs.
Number 5.
If there were a way of adding up the elements that make a game a JRPG, this game would get 0 points for gameplay, but full marks for story and setting.
Xenoblade Chronicles is probably the most typical JRPG story on this list. Shulk must take up the mystical Monado to battle the evil Mechons that threaten to destroy all humanity. Xenoblade actually has a really cool setup, with the whole world actually being the corpses of two titanic creatures that died fighting each other eons ago, but they were so massive that life sprung up on their cadavers. But it's a pretty standard save the world narrative with a cast of characters familiar to any veterans of the genre or of anime, albeit with somewhat out-of-place British accents.
If I can just get it off, I should be able to...
There's also an interesting wrinkle thrown in the mix with the Monado showing Shulk visions of the future that he sometimes manages to change, but other times is powerless to prevent. And the future vision stuff is even integrated into the combat. The combat itself is ripped wholesale out of MMOs, with characters auto-attacking as long as they are in range. Your direct control is based around a selection of skills you can use with cooldowns. I'm not familiar with MMO combat systems in general, but I was surprised how in control I felt of these battles, even though your team was basically attacking on autopilot.
The biggest problem with this game is that it's on the Wii. It's got large, open-ended environments with free-roaming enemies, and those kind of things don't fit well on the Wii's processor, Monster Hunter!
Also, GameStop has some pretty jacked-up prices on the used copies of this game, so it's not easy to get cheap. But it was an awfully engaging game on both a mechanical and story level. Number 4. Anachronox. Remember Ion Storm, the company that made the hilariously overhyped Daikatana? Well, they also made the excellent Deus Ex and the pretty good Anachronox. If your problem with JRPGs has always been the distinctly Japanese narratives, then this is the game for you. This one's a weird combo of noir detective with a lot of sci-fi concepts that eventually result in a bog-standard save-the-universe narrative that ends on a cliffhanger that you are just gonna have to accept is never gonna be resolved. It's got this wry British kind of humor that arises from good characters and genuinely clever ideas. It's a mouse-driven game, but your on-screen mouse is an actual character in the game. She's an AI construct that keeps track of your menus and shows up in some cutscenes. The first party member you get is an old man who has a special attack where he blathers incessantly at the enemy until their defense drops. And later, you get a party member that is a literal planet that you save from destruction. The governing body voted to shrink their planet down to aid you in battle, because they could. And it's a good thing the story is so entertaining, because the combat sure isn't. It's this clunky, weird, position-dependent variant of standard turn-based combat. It's slow and dull and does this weird thing where the camera flies all over the place.
Time to read the newspaper.
Thankfully, the combat is rare, as few areas have random encounters, and the out-of-combat gameplay has some intriguing puzzle design, so definitely worth a look, if for the novelty of an American JRPG alone. Number 3. Earthbound. Hey look, it's the first JRPG I ever finished. Remember how I said that a lot of JRPGs stop their story halfway through to go on an overlong collectathon section? That's basically the whole game for Earthbound, but then it spits in the face of more boring JRPGs by making itself so damn funny. You start off as a small town boy who receives a save the world quest from a time-traveling psychic bumblebee. In the first town, you fight skaters and the police. By the second town, you're fighting insane cultists who paint the whole world blue, even the cows. And by the third town, you're trapping zombies with flypaper and fighting giant anthropomorphic barf. Of course, if you're at all familiar with Earthbound, you know there's quite a bit of dark weirdness underneath all the quirky lol randomness. But more so than the alleged fetus killing in the final boss fight, I was way more traumatized by an earlier scene. You switch perspectives for a moment to take control of Prince Pooh. You ascend a mountain to do some meditation when the creepy spirit of your grandfather floats down. He then proceeds to rip off your arms and legs and tear at your eyes, ears, and tongue.
Jesus!
Occasional mind raping aside, this is just a really good JRPG. Yeah, it's a little clunky, but if you can get sucked into the story, this will be a really great experience.
And it's finally available on the Wii U eShop, which also drove down the price of the original cartridges on eBay to about $100. So, if you don't already have a Wii U, maybe the original cartridge is worth it for you.
Number 2.
I debated the orders of 2 and 3 on this list for quite a long time. But what it eventually came down to is that JRPGs are about telling a story. And no story has ever moved me quite like the story of Lucas trying to find his brother.
Mother 3. Mother 3 has almost nothing to do with the tale of Earthbound, even though it's the sequel. It tells its own tale of a small island village that slowly becomes overrun by bizarre hybrid creatures, a strange army of pig masks, and the encroachment of modern technology! But even with the continued presence of the lol random humor element, Mother 3 manages to pull out an almost incredible degree of pathos for these small sprite people living on your Game Boy Advance screen. Just watch this scene where Clint learns his wife is dead.
Thank you.
This game made me cry. Not just this part either. Despite being confined onto a single island, the story of Mother 3 manages to be a world-saving epic that also feels like a personal tale about Lucas and his family.
This game is just so damn good, and why has it never been released in English?
Yes, I know Earthbound didn't sell well in the US, but come on, Nintendo! How much would it cost you to release this on the Virtual Console? Especially considering that all the translating has been done for you. The amazing folks over at Starman.net spent years creating an English version of Mother 3, and they did an amazing job. If you don't like emulators, I'm sorry, but you're just gonna have to put up with it, because this is a gaming experience you should not miss. And if you're worried about the technicals, it's not that hard to set up. Usability was important to these folks.
And now, before we get to number one, some honorable mentions.
Skies of Arcadia has a lot of the mechanical conventions that turn me off of the JRPG genre, but it gets a mention for just being a fun story. You are pirates of the sky, and you go on huge, epic quests. You go exploring, get into airship battles, and the characters just seem to be having a great time. It's nice to have a story where you save the world not just because you live on it, but because it's an adventure, and adventures are fun! Persona 4 was gonna have the number 5 spot on my list, but as I got further into it, I discovered I had solved the central mystery of the plot long before the in-game characters were gonna solve it. But it's got an engaging combat system with a crafting element that you can dump hours into. Atlas pulls their usual shtick of half the game being a Japanese life simulator and the other half being a JRPG in an alternate world. The two bits fit together better than I thought they would.
Plus, it's one of the best games you can get for the PlayStation Vita. So if you've already got one of these, you might as well buy it.
I wanted to put Mother 1 on the list, but I couldn't in good conscience. This game is just broken in some ways. It's a game from the NES, so the graphics look but ugly now. The quirky weirdness hadn't fully seeped into the series yet, and just becomes a chore at times. The developer admitted that they didn't even level balance the last section of the game. I managed to muscle through it, but unless you're a huge fan of the Mother series, you can easily skip this one. Or watch Chugga Conroy's Let's Play. I personally think that the Super Nintendo JRPGs have aged horribly and only get a free pass because of nostalgia. I don't care how good the story is, it's hidden behind this archaic game design. But Bravely Default feels like those games done with a modern brush. Yeah, it's got a lot of questionable design choices, but the game is just much more accessible. The Brave Default mechanic adds an interesting tactical wrinkle, and the full voice acting really helps bring your party to life. Number 1.
May have the best story of any JRPG I've ever played, but games aren't just about story. Truly great games engage you on a story and mechanical level. And no game has ever moved my heart or my fingers quite like a little-known game on the Nintendo DS.
The world ends with you. Yahtzee probably said it best when he said,
"A JRPG just isn't a JRPG unless it ends with teenagers using the power of friendship to kill God."
And Twewe really internalizes that idea of the power of friendship as a central theme, not just a secondary one that the game assumes you're on board with as a rule, like gravity pulling things down or water being wet. So you play a stereotypical rapscallion of Japan's streets, Neku. He wears headphones to block out people talking, loves graffiti art, and introduces himself with the phrase, "I don't get people. Never have, never will." So yeah, he's a complete wanker. He gets killed in an accident and gets sucked into an alternate reality battleground where other recently deadites pair up to battle the Reapers and their pet monsters, the Noise, over the course of a 7-day battle game, with a chance to come back to life at the end of the tournament. The pairing part is important, as Neku's slow crawl out of misanthropy is much more important than the eventual Save the City storyline. The three different people he gets paired with all give him a different humanist experience. For the first week, he gets the most impossibly patient and forgiving partner who puts up with his loner bullshit and tries to pry him out of his shell. By the second week, the narrative and mechanical training wheels get taken off and he gets the sarcastic prick who seems untrustworthy. Third week, he gets the well-meaning but clumsy blockhead that makes you want to clunk him in the back of the head with a cinder block in the vain hope it will give him some extra IQ points. The character pairings manifest in the gameplay as well, as this game has some of the best use of the DS hardware I've ever seen. You control both characters at the same time, your partner on the top screen with the D-pad, and Neku on the bottom screen with the stylus. The combat is ridiculously deep with a lot of options. The dual screen thing is complicated and takes getting used to, but it's absolutely worth it and well designed around the concept of changing which character you control. And if you can't grasp it, they do include a competent AI for the top screen partner.
Seriously, Square Enix, sequel this! Or at the very least, port it to the Wii U. It is literally the only other system that can handle this game's awesomeness. Whew! Well, thank you for joining me for this list of my favorite JRPGs. Now I'm gonna go back to reviewing my specialty, Japanese porn comics. Ever since I was a young boy, I played the silver ball. From Soho down to Brighton, I must have played them all. But I ain't seen nothing like him in any amusement hall. That damn dumb flag kid sure plays a mean ball.